Okay, so tonight, you know, we may hit this again next week, but because we probably won't cover very many. But, you know, prophetically, we're going to talk about types of the Antichrist. We've been on the Antichrist for a little while. Some people may say, well, I don't really plan on being here whenever the Antichrist shows up, so why are you spending all this time? Well, I don't know. I hope you're right. I hope we don't see him at all. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I have a feeling that we're going to see a little bit. As a matter of fact, next week, probably the week after, we're going to really break down 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I believe that that's kind of where we may start to see that that we might see a little bit more than maybe what we expected, you know. But there's a lot smarter men than me that have gone before me that would say maybe something different. But nevertheless, I think that we should be able to notice the types also whenever they happen, because there's been multiple types of the Antichrist that have existed. We talked about that last week, about the fact that there's a spirit of Antichrist and that there's been many Antichrists, not just the ones that we see in the Scripture, but also ones that are even modern times now. People that want to hold down God's people. And also, I believe, without the shadow of a doubt, we talked about this. You know, a couple of weeks back, that many times they speak with smooth words of wisdom and smooth words of flattery that are deceptive, and they're being anointed by demonic spirits. People say that whenever Adolf Hitler spoke to the crowds, that they were literally mesmerized by, because there was an anointing on his life. It wasn't a Holy Spirit anointing, obviously, but there was an anointing on his life. You may not like me to say this. Maybe I'm not supposed to say it on the camera, but I'm going to say it anyway. Whenever the first time I heard President Obama speak, I'm telling you right now, I knew a lot of things. I mean, I knew a lot about the Scriptures, and I'm not impressed easily. I'm just not. I mean, I don't know why, but I'm not. But when that man started speaking, I just had it on. It was before he even said he was running for president or anything like that. It was like whenever they first start talking about it. And supposedly at the time only Hillary was running, and he was up there kind of just pumping up the Democratic Party. That's what it was, the Democratic National Convention. And he was the guest speaker. And when he started to speak, I'm telling you, I stopped what I was doing. I can remember, and I just kind of was glued to the television listening, and I was absorbed and taken in. Now, I mean, it's not going to happen anymore, but nevertheless, I was almost not mesmerized. I don't want to give him too much credit, but nevertheless, I was overtaken like by it. It caught my attention. And so all I'm trying to say is that these kinds of things happen, you know, and that these people are being used by the enemy, and this has been going on through the ages. But prophetically and historically, we have types and shadows within the Scriptures, and there's multiple of them, in my opinion, and we wouldn't be able to cover them all anyway. But tonight we'll probably get through at least a couple of them. The first one I wanted to talk to you about is Nimrod. And I'll be honest, we've talked about Nimrod quite a bit in the Bible study or at this church, but there's no better type of the Antichrist, in my opinion, than Nimrod. If you look at chapter 10 of Genesis, verse 8, it says, in Genesis 10, verse 8, it says, "And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth." Now, the interesting thing is that the word mighty, literally in the Hebrew, is Gibor, G-I-B-B-O-R. And it's also the same word that's translated for the Nephilim. When it talks about the mighty men of old, if y'all are familiar with the terminology Nephilim, some of you may not be. But in Genesis chapter 6, the Bible says, and I mean, I might have even mentioned this last week. If I did, I apologize. I talk about it a lot, but that the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men. And what that was talking about was fallen angels cohabiting with the daughters of men, and that there were Nephilim. Or the word is giants in the land, but when you look up the word giant, it's literally Nephilim in the Hebrew. And then the word mighty men is Gibor, same word being used to describe Nimrod. Now, to say that he was definitely a Nephilim, there's some extra biblical archaeological stuff that says that, but we don't have any proof biblically of that. Okay, but what it is saying is that he was mighty, he was a chieftain, he was a powerful man. This word is also used to actually describe God in some cases, the same word. And really, that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing that there were mighty men of the earth and even the Nephilim that were worshipped and revered as gods. And in Nimrod's post-flood time frame, that's the same thing that's going on. He's a mighty man on the earth. He's being revered in such a way. He has such an influence on people. As a matter of fact, if you turn to Genesis 9, just turn back one page, verse 1, And it says in Genesis 9, verse 1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Okay, back to chapter 10. What's happening is that Nimrod is going in direct opposition to what God told him to do. He's rebelling against God. Some scholars say that his name literally means the rebel. So he's Nimrod. He's mighty before. He's a mighty hunter. He's a mighty man, but he's a mighty hunter before the Lord. Josephus, the Jewish historian, said that he was a hunter for the souls of men, and that he wasn't just hunting beasts, but that he was literally hunting the souls of men to turn them away from the true God. All right, and then it goes on to say here that. He was before the Lord. And the word before there literally means to be in the face of. So the idea isn't that, oh, God's looking at him and he's a mighty hunter and so God's pleased with him. No, the idea is that he's in direct defiance. He's a rebel against God and he's a mighty hunter before the Lord. So he's in the Lord's face and he's directly defying God and everything that God has asked mankind to do. Nimrod is moving in the opposite direction and he's pulling humanity with him. And so it goes on to say right here before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calna in the land of Shinar. Out of the land went forth Asher and built Nineveh and the city. Okay, and now we can go to Genesis chapter 11. I just wanted you to see that part right there where it says, and the beginning of his kingdom. And because, you know, we're going to talk a little bit, he built the Tower of Babel, which was a ziggurotic structure, meaning that that it was flat on top, whereas the pyramids in Egypt of Giza, the three pyramids of Giza, are pointed at the top. And I did a little research, and it seems as though the mystery religions in these took place on the inside. They had all kinds of rooms and stuff, whereas in these ziggurotic structures, they did their sacrificing on top of it, where everyone could see. And so, but the beginning of his kingdom was here. And what I want you to know is that we're going to be comparing a lot of scripture, but it comes to a fruition whenever we're looking at where we are now, Mystery Babylon. And we're going to look at a little bit, I'm not going to spend too much time, but financial Babylon. And even also the concept of governmental Babylon, which is, we've already talked about it, the beast that's connected to the harlot, which is really Mystery Babylon, okay? And so Nimrod's the starter of all this. And this is the beginning of his kingdom. And so if we go on to Nimrod's Babylonian system. I wanted to just talk about that for a second too, because I did a little bit of research. And, you know, the idea, this was actually where his kingdom started. And I've tried to draw pictures for you before. And I know that if you're on the video, you can't really see it. So maybe I'll even draw a little map right here so that you can see. But those two rivers that y'all are looking at on that map, that's the Tigris and the Euphrates River. And they run about like that. And this land in between is known as Mesopotamia, okay, which literally means the land between the rivers. And as you can see there, Babylon is down here. I think they're pointing at Babel, well, it wouldn't be in the river, but somewhere around here. And Abraham, it was from Ur, which was down here, okay? And so Israel is over this way. And this is, once again, the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea. And then the Mediterranean's over here off to the left. And so Israel is between here. And all this area here is called the Fertile Crescent. And this was a very major thoroughfare. Egypt's down here, right? And so everybody wanted this land because of the travel that went through. And so Nimrod's area or land or the beginning of his kingdom was all this area here. And I just wanted you to be able to see that. I started doing some research, and what I began to uncover was that the Babylonian banking system, archaeologically, 3,000, 4,000 BC, there were documents that were found that discussed the fact that people were already trading in precious metals, weighted metals, or the weight of barley. They would weigh out a certain amount of barley, and they would trade according to precious metals. So we have documents that show that. Why is that even important? Because what I want you to understand is that this is probably the time frame around Nimrod and all of these things that are being instituted. And he's bringing humanity together in one area, and he's teaching them various things. And so this financial system is being started, this Babylonian religious system, the Mystery Babylon is being started. And, right now we see Greece's economy is falling apart. Greece's economy is falling apart. I did a little bit of research and I found out that China, some things are happening with China. I don't watch the news anymore, but there's a lot going on, so I probably ought to start watching the news again, or at least reading the paper. There's a lot of things happening quick. Am I saying that this is it? I have to tell you that, you know, this isn't the first time that Greece's economy has collapsed. As a matter of fact, about four years ago it happened. And one of the things that was interesting to me was, this is whenever I was starting to do some of this kinds of research that I've been doing here recently, was that I saw an interview of a man named George Soros. Now, you may not be familiar with George Soros, but he's a multi-billionaire. And he's got a very interesting past. When he was 17, he was alive during World War II, and he's actually a Jew, but he helped the Nazis find where Jewish people were hidden in order to be arrested. In turn, he received properties and monies. And on this interview, they were asking him about that, and they asked him how he felt about it. Don't you feel bad? He's like, oh, no, absolutely not. I was doing what I was supposed to do. As the interview went on, they talked about some of the decisions that he was making that was going to weaken the American dollar. And with a smile on his face, I saw with my own eyes, he said, a weak American dollar is a good thing. And then he went on to talk about the fact that they said how he had collapsed the Grecian economy. And so this isn't the first time this has happened. Now, after that, I was reading, actually, you let me read that book by a portion of it, or you told me about it, Eric John Phelps. It's called Vatican Assassins, right? Yeah, he doesn't play with his words. He just tells it like it is. Vatican Assassins, about the secret history of the Jesuits. And one of the things that was connected to that had to do with the fact that George Soros works for the Rothschild family. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, this is the beginning of his kingdom, Nimrod's Babylonian system. But at the same time, this has been continuing on and going on through the ages, and that it's coming to a fulfillment. And then I just wanted you to notice a couple of more things. This is one of the scriptures in Genesis 11:4, and it says, "And they said, go to and let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." So, direct opposition to what God has asked them to do. He asked them to replenish the earth, to spread upon the earth. You know, Revelation 5:9, we quoted that scripture a couple of times recently. It talks about the fact that Jesus redeemed us out of all tribes, tongues, and nations. God's plan was for the earth to be repopulated, amen, and for there to be different countries, different people groups, and for those people groups to ultimately be redeemed by Jesus, amen, that we would be a peculiar people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, amen, purchased by Jesus. But Nimrod, and he's already planning to come against the plan of God. And then I just wanted to compare to you the scripture out of Revelation 14:8, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And so the early stages of Babylon, this is where it was began to be built, it was called Babel. And then at the end, it's fallen. And I just thought it was interesting how in the Genesis passage, it says that let us build ourselves a city and a tower that reaches unto heaven. But in the Revelation passage, it says that Babylon is fallen, just as Lucifer himself, who's really the one that's behind Nimrod, fell from heaven to earth. And this scripture right here talks about the fact, I just wanted to use this kind of as an analogy, really, that in Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 through 5, we see the scripture tells us that Satan is described as a serpent, and in Revelation 12:9, he's described as a dragon, but that yet it's still connected back to the fact that he's a serpent. The point that I'm trying to make is that there's a maturation process that's taking place. You understand? He starts off as a snake in the garden, and as time goes through, and he's working his plan, and really, in Revelation 17, when it talks about the beast, it's it's a seven-headed beast, which is a number of completion. And so his plan has come to a place of fulfillment and a place of completion. Well, in a similar way to the way that Satan has gone from a serpent to a dragon, is the same thing having to do with Nimrod's Babylonian system. It starts off here. God confuses the languages, amen. But with time, it's still moving forward, and the enemy still has his plan, and ultimately it comes to a place of fulfillment. And that's basically what I put here. Same thing having to do with the seven heads and Mystery Babylon and all those things like that. So there's no reason to. Now, this is one of the things I wanted to look at this. This is Genesis 11, verses 4 and 5. And I just underlined because it says, and well, starting off in verse, well, let me just read the whole passage. Genesis 11, starting in verse 1. The whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick, and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach into heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth. Now, one of the things that's interesting, right, is that the New Jerusalem, which is God's city that Jesus said to Philip, he said, in my Father's house are many mansions, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. If it wasn't so, then I wouldn't tell you. Jesus is going to prepare a place. That city, that New Jerusalem, is going to descend down to man. See, God is the one that's pure. God is the one that's holy. The earth is fallen. And in this picture, mankind is trying to build himself and to get himself to God. Now, another interesting thing is that the word Babel literally means gate, the gate of God, or the gate of the gods. Now, that's where a lot of this concept about stargates and all those other things come into play. But what's happening here is that on top of this ziggurat structure is that there's sacrifices that are being offered up. And so this was one of the things, and I know I've shared this with many of you before, this was one of the things that I used to be really confused of whenever I would read this Genesis account. And it talked about the fact that they were reaching into the heavens with this tower. And I'm like, Lord, why are you so concerned about them reaching into the heavens with the tower? You're not concerned about skyscrapers and things like that. But really what's happening is that they're engaging in occult worship, human sacrifice, and other various things that are, if it could be possibly worse. And they're engaging the spiritual realm. They're engaging the second heavens. And in reality, so what Nimrod has done is that he's defied God. He's caused humanity to come over with him. They're building a city for themselves. They're building a name for themselves. They're building a tower, and they're worshiping Satan under this one man, Nimrod's rule. And in reality, that's exactly what the Antichrist will also do. He's going to try to pull the world back together under one religious system, under one financial system, under one governmental system, and he's going to attempt to cause the whole world. As a matter of fact, the Word of God says in the book of Revelation that anyone whose name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life on the earth will worship the beast, because they will have taken the mark of the beast also. And so there are going to be some tribulation saints. Now, I have to tell you that the truth is that I believe that by that time, whenever the Antichrist is in full force, we're not going to be here, amen? But nevertheless, there will be people that realize in the midst of it all that what the situation is, and they're not going to give in to the beast system. They're not going to take the mark. And so therefore, if their names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, amen, they'll hold on to Jesus through it all, and they themselves will not worship the liar. Now, one of the things that I wanted to point out real quick is how I underlined, it says, let us build us a city. And then it says, let us make us a name. And then it says, the tower which the children of men built. And so I started thinking about that. And, you know, it says, they said, let us build ourselves a city. Let us build ourselves a tower, the children of men. And I compared that to Revelation 13:8, where it talks about the number of the beast, 666, and that it's the number of a man. And that in reality, what's going on with the whole number of the beast, the number of a man, is it all goes back to the spirit of New Age. And it's mankind, just as at the Tower of Babel, coming together in corporate disobedience, in corporate rebellion, throwing their lot in with Satan in order to bring this thing to pass. The truth of the matter is that Satan has to use men in order to deceive and in order to receive the glory that he desires to receive. And the reason I say that is that Anton LaVey's even quoted, the founder of the Satanic Church. He's even quoted, I read it multiple times, I heard him say it, that they had to change their tactics. See, it wasn't too bad whenever people would flock, and I don't, you know, I mean, we're at least PG-13, I've said that before. People would flock to the party house where the Church of Satan was because, like, there was a lot of drugs and there was a lot of partying going on, and so men would be happy to be there too because there was a lot of women there and there was a lot of things that were going on in that type of surrounding and scenario. But when people started questioning and started thinking, so we're really worshiping Satan here? Is that what we're really doing? I mean, come on, man, really? I mean, like, in other words, you can tell us the truth now. Are we really worshiping Satan? This is just all for fun, right? And when people started realizing that they were really worshiping Satan, it didn't stay fun. You understand what I'm getting at? And people started bailing out on him. And so he said, yeah, we had to repackage ourselves. And we had to say, no, of course we're not really worshiping Satan. That's all a ploy to get people and, you know, whatever the case. My point is that Satan, if he comes, because see, God is the one, he's got a copyright on your soul. Amen? God's got a copyright on the human soul. And there's something in man. Now, some people will. They'll give their heart and their allegiance to Satan for power and greed and whatever the case. But for the most part, most of humanity is not going to just willingly give their life over to the liar. And so they have to be deceived into it. And in a similar fashion, that's what the Antichrist is going to do. He's not going to come first telling you that to worship Satan. No, that'll sooner or later, that's the plan. But ultimately, he's going to show up first as a counterfeit Christ, as the Antichrist. And he's going to say, more than likely, that he is the Son of God. And along with what he's doing, there's going to be miracles and various things like that. So I just wanted you to see that. Now, Pharaoh's enslavement. Pharaoh is number two, and there's a lot to be said about Pharaoh. We could say, first of all, he wants to enslave God's people. He also is revered as God. I mean, all of the pharaohs were called Ra, which was the sun god. But you know, this was one of the things that I thought was interesting. I never really had noticed this before. Out of Isaiah 52. In Isaiah 52, it says in verse 4, "For thus says the Lord God, my people went down aforetime into Egypt to sojourn there, and the Assyrian oppressed them without cause." I thought that was interesting. So when they went to Egypt, it says the Assyrian oppressed them. Well, Assyria is part of Nimrod's original kingdom. Assyria was up here in the north, and at times it spread all the way across to Syria. It took over Israel, and there's a lot of evidence that says at some point in time they even spread all the way down to Egypt. Now, one of the things that I learned when I was in school, which was interesting, and actually if you turn to Genesis chapter 47... Genesis 47, starting in verse 5, it says, "And Pharaoh spoke unto Joseph, saying, Your father and your brethren are come unto thee. The land of Egypt is before thee, and the best of the land. Make your father and brethren to dwell in the land of Goshen. Let them dwell, and if thou knowest any men of activity among them, then make them rulers over my cattle." So as we can see right here in this first passage of Scripture, Pharaoh is definitely not opposed to Joseph. Amen. Joseph is a blessing to Pharaoh. We know the story. If you remember the story, Joseph had interpreted the dream, right? That there were going to be 7 years of plenty and then there was going to be 7 years of famine. And Joseph prepared Egypt in order to be a blessing to the entirety of the world. And so in these passages of scripture, it's obvious that Pharaoh is loves Joseph. It says in verse 10 of 47, and Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from before Pharaoh. And then it goes on to say in verse, but if you turn all the way to Exodus chapter 1, verse 8, it says, now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. And so there was a new king that showed up. And the reality of it is that according to the Isaiah passage, it appears, and also archaeologically it seems, that the Assyrians from up north came down and infiltrated and conquered. Amen. And so it says that an Assyrian actually oppressed them. And so an Assyrian was acting as Pharaoh at the time. But in Isaiah, he also goes on and on talking about the Assyrian oppressing his people. It says right here, I believe it is in Isaiah chapter 10. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 24. It says, therefore, thus saith the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwellest in the land of Zion, be not afraid of the Assyrian. He shall smite thee with a rod, and shall lift up his staff against thee after the manner of Egypt. For yet a little while, and the indignation shall cease, and mine anger in their destruction. And the Lord of hosts shall stir up a scourge for him according to the slaughter of Midian at the rock of Oreb. And as his rod was upon the sea, so shall he lift it up after the manner of Egypt. And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder and his yoke from off thy neck. And thy yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. And so the anointing is talking about the anointed one, ultimately Jesus that would come. The truth is that I believe that there's a double reference here, that there was an Assyrian Pharaoh that held God's people in bondage, but also that the Antichrist will be coming from the area of Assyria. Some people say even more specifically Syria, which all this also has to do with the area of the old Roman Empire. I find it also interesting in chapter 11, because we're talking about the anointing, that it says in chapter 11, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, which is talking about Jesse, which is David's father, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Amen. So remember, the word anointing literally means to be smeared with oil, which is representative of having the Holy Spirit placed upon you. Amen. So the kings were anointed, David was anointed, Aaron was anointed, and in this case, it's talking about the seed, the branch that will come out of Jesse, and that the Spirit of God would rest upon him. And whenever Jesus was baptized, amen, the Holy Spirit descended and rested upon him. I just happened to find this. If you want to turn over to Isaiah chapter 9, it doesn't really have anything to do with Egypt, but I thought it was interesting. It's still talking about Jesus, amen. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, this is a very popular scripture that we're all familiar with. It says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. See, that's talking about the millennial reign of Christ right there. After the battle of Armageddon, amen, Jesus is going to rule and reign on the throne. The Antichrist is going to make his attempt to come against the people of God and the plan of God. But the anointed one, Jesus, amen, is going to destroy him with the sword of his mouth. And the government will be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. The Lord sent a word unto Jacob, and it had lighted upon Israel. Now this is what I wanted to show you. In verse 9 right here, it says, and all the people shall know, even Ephraim, of the inhabitant of Samaria. Now, let me just take just a second real quick.
to say this. Ephraim was considered really one of the most northern parts of Israel. Ephraim and then Samaria was kind of more in the middle. And to be honest with you, if you'll remember the story, and you may not, of Jeroboam, who was the king when the kingdom was split, he took two golden calves. He took two golden calves just like Aaron built for the children of Israel 1,000 years before that. And he put one in the area of Samaria, and he put another one in Dan, which was in the northern part. But whenever you hear the word Ephraim talked about, it's talking about northern Israel, the northern 10 tribes. They use that word collectively to talk about the northern 10 tribes, which were going against God, which were the idolatrous tribes that actually led Judah to go into the wrong direction also. And so he's talking about Ephraim right here, and I just wanted to make the point of Ephraim and Samaria were the northern kingdom, and in Samaria were where those golden calves were used. So what I'm saying is that this was full of idolatry. Full of idolatry, and the people of God were worshiping false gods. And this is what's interesting right here in verse 9. All the people shall know, even Ephraim and the inhabitant of Samaria, that say in the pride and stoutness of heart, the bricks are fallen, but we will build with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will change them into cedars. The reason this is interesting is because on 9/11, they actually quoted this scripture. The government quoted this scripture and said that we will rebuild. And they said in the spirit of Isaiah chapter 9, verses 9 and 10, we will rebuild. And what this is actually talking about is the judgment of God falling upon these areas of Israel. And the reason that the bricks are fallen is because the wrath of God has fallen upon them. And so they use this scripture to say that we will rebuild, and many people believe that it wasn't accidental, but that it was actually purposeful, and that they were talking about the rebellious nature behind what they were doing to begin with. And so anyway, it was right there, so I figured I would mention it to you. So these plagues right here, I thought that this was interesting, because we're talking about Pharaoh, we're talking about the enslavement of God's people. And I put a comparison because in the book of Exodus, you know, God says to Pharaoh, let my people go. He wants his people to have the freedom and the liberty to be able to go into the wilderness, to hold a feast unto him, to be able to have to hold the Passover, to be able to worship him, amen, with sacrifice. And not the Passover, but to hold a feast of sacrifice unto them. And Pharaoh refuses to let go. And so in the midst of all this, we see these various plagues that hit in order to cause Pharaoh to change his mind, in order to cause Pharaoh to let go and to release God's people. We see the waters turn to blood. We see the land filled with frogs. We see the boils, the hail, the locusts, and the darkness. I'm not going to really spend, we're not going to go through each one and read all of those scriptures because it would take too long. But I did want to focus on at least a couple of them. But before I even go there, and you can turn with me if you want to, I wanted to just make a point out of Exodus chapter 9. Actually, Exodus chapter 10. And if you're right there at 10, you're probably close to 9:35, and it's just repeatedly similar type scriptures. Exodus 9:35, and the heart of Pharaoh was hardened, neither would he let the children of Israel go, as the Lord had spoken by Moses. Chapter 10, verse 1. And the Lord said unto Moses, go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him. And then over at Exodus chapter 10, verse 20, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he would not let the children of Israel go. You know, the scripture goes back and forth. It says Pharaoh hardened his heart towards the Lord, but then it turns around and it says that the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. It can happen in our own lives. We can harden our own heart towards God, and God will turn around and he can harden our hearts towards. But this is something specific, amen, that God is purposefully hardening Pharaoh's heart. You and I need to understand, when I first started doing research on all of these other things that were happening, there was so much information out there that it started to, I got to be honest with you, it started to confuse me a little bit.
And I started getting concerned because I started seeing how powerful the occult was. But what I began to realize was that the book was written. Amen. The book was written and that God is sovereign and he is in control. And I personally believe that the book was written in such a way that he knew the liar was going to know exactly how the book was written. And that the liar was going to attempt to fulfill the prophecies through his own ways of doing it. But that God knew beforehand exactly how he was going to do it. And that God hardened the heart of Pharaoh in order to cause him to move forward. And so what I'm trying to tell you is, okay, good. I know that the Rothschild family and the, seems like the Rockefellers own the whole international banking industry. So what? And yeah, they planned it all. They started it in the 1700s and they're going to try to cause the financial markets to collapse. As a matter of fact, the first time you see the financial markets collapse, I don't think that that's Revelation 18. Whenever Revelation 18 shows up and financial Babylon is broken and is sinking and all of the merchants of the earth begin to bewail, it's because God has showed up and his wrath has hit it. Amen. And it's not hallelujah because the Lord is going to judge financial Babylon. He's going to judge mystery Babylon. And he's going to judge the governments of Babylon. But at the same time, there's a conspiracy that's working on the earth. And it's deep, dark magic. That's the best way to describe it. I'm telling you. It's infiltrated governments. It's infiltrated theology. The higher institutions that tell people to, teach people to teach the Bible. I know. They're there. And they know half the time, they don't even know what they're doing. And they're changing the way that the gospel is being preached. And the churches are even asleep because the truth of the gospel is not going forth anymore. And that's how people, and listen, it's widespread. And it's happened for so long. And it's so such a slow process that we don't even realize it. Because we don't know half the time what happened in the 1950s anymore. Much less what happened 100, 150 years ago. And so I just wanted you to, I wanted you to be aware of that, you know, God hardened Pharaoh's heart, but that God allows these things to take place. So we should never, whenever we start reading, like sooner or later, we're going to get into it. Listen, this is what it is. This is not hard to figure out. The Rothschild family had something to do with modern day Israel. They financed it. I mean, I don't know what that does to you right now, but when I first heard it, I was like, what? What is that? Listen, this isn't just something I've looked up on Wikipedia. This is something that I showed up in an antique store in Mobile, Alabama, and I'm walking down the book aisles of all these books that they have, and I'm trying to learn something about the Jewish history, and there's a Jewish encyclopedia, and it says something in the back. I just heard about the Rothschild family. It had their name in there, so I bought the book for $10, threw it in the back of my trunk, never looked at it again until I started working on my series of occult exposure, pull out this big old Jewish encyclopedia, History of the Jews, start reading on the Rothschild family. They're the financiers of the Jewish state. And it says it right there in the book that they were Kabbalah Jews. Well, what's the Kabbalah? It's ancient mystery religion. It's Eastern mysticism. It's the worship of the devil. Aleister Crowley practiced Kabbalah. Okay? We got a problem, Houston, but God's in control. Amen? And he hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he can harden a Rothschild heart, and he can harden anybody's heart, and they can go around doing whatever it is they want to do, and they can try to manipulate, but the whole time the Bible says that the God in the heavens, he laughs at them. Amen. Because God has a plan, amen? And his plan will prevail. Hallelujah. Make sure you're on the right side, amen? All right. So what I wanted you to see was that there's got these plagues right here, and one of them that kind of stood out to me a little bit was the one about the frogs. Now this is, actually, these plagues were all targeted specific Egyptian deities. This particular one is, her name is Heket. I guess that's how you pronounce it. It's H-E-Q-E-T. And she was the frog goddess. And how would you pronounce that? Okay, I thought if it was Heket, it would have a U after it. But anyway, you get the point. Frog goddess. And you can see that she kind of has a face that looks like a frog. And if you looked at the bigger pictures in this one, both times there's a smaller man standing on a table, which is kind of interesting because it's like the Pharaoh or a god is sitting in the chair and is really large. Almost has the impression of what you would call a giant or a Nephilim. And then in this one here, she's got knives, and there's a man standing on the table just like that right there. So it's almost like she's about to sacrifice him. But So that was just one of the ones that I thought was interesting, and I did want to look at Revelation 16, 13 through 14. Because, you know, in Revelation, there's multiple movements of the wrath of God that's being poured out in the book of Revelation. What I mean is that I think it's right around the sixth seal, is that all of a sudden there's an earthquake that takes place. Amen. The sun gets black. It's not shining. The moon, it turns. I can't even really, you know what? Let's go ahead. And I don't want to tell you a lie. I'm going to turn to there first. It says in Revelation 6:12. You don't have to turn there because we're about to go forward. I'm just reading to you right now. You keep going to Revelation 16, and I'm turning back to Revelation 6 to read something to you real quick. You don't have to stress. I'm going to read it to you. All right? Revelation 6, verse 12. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, the moon became as blood, the stars of heaven fell into the earth, even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. Now, the reason I wanted to turn to that was I wanted to make a point. There's multiple movements of the wrath of God taking place in the book of Revelation. Up until this point right here, though, in my opinion, everything that's preceded this does not necessarily have to be considered truly the wrath of God. The reason that I say that, we're going to teach it when we get there, is when the first seal is opened, it's the Antichrist that comes forth. And the next thing you know, it says he's given power to strike the land with war and famine. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that what we're saying is that if this Babylonian empire that was started with Nimrod and this whole banking industry is really what I believe is going on, and this financial Babylon of Revelation 18 is really can be manipulated by men, then it doesn't have to mean that when the economy collapses or there's famine in the land, that yes, it's the wrath of God in an inadvertent way because the Lamb opened the seal, amen, and allowed the Antichrist, gave him a crown and let him go to conquer, but it's not really the wrath of God hidden like it is in Revelation chapter 6 verse 12. Whenever stars start falling from the sky and the sun turns black and the moon gets red like blood, you understand what I'm saying? Man can't do all that stuff. He can't turn the sun black and cause stars to fall from the sky. He can't cause the moon to turn unless it's a blood moon, you know, like we're talking about. But you get the point that I'm making. This is the wrath of God, and man can't reproduce this. All right. So now, we're going back to Revelation chapter 16, verses 13 through 14. So this isn't really a plague like it was in Egypt, but I think it's interesting, and I wanted to just point it out to you. I was just trying to make a comparison that there was a plague of frogs in Egypt, but that there's something connected to frogs and also that goddess, that frog goddess. Remember how I've told you many times before that these statues that are made to gods and goddesses, that it's really demon spirits or fallen angels that they're constructing these things to in order to give their obeisance or worship to. And so I just found it interesting that in the book of Revelation, where it talks about frogs in chapter 16, verse 13 and 14, it says, "And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty." Now, ain't that something? I think I noticed that for the first time today. These lion spirits that look like frogs are proceeding out of the mouth of the dragon, proceeding out of the mouth of the false prophet, out of the mouth of the Antichrist. And they're enticing the kings of the earth. They've deceived them through the miracles that they worked, and convinced them that they have the power, and they're leading these kings of the earth into the valley of Armageddon in order to go to battle against God. And you know, they've been completely deceived. And that goes back to that Psalm chapter 2, you know, when it talks about why do the heathen rage, and why do the people imagine a vain thing, and that the kings of the earth have and the rulers of the earth have come together against God and his anointed. It says that God is in the heavens and he laughs at them. And it tells the kings of the earth, kiss the sun. Kiss him now while you have the chance. meaning you need to pay your obeisance and your worship to the Son of God. Amen? Amen. Because there's coming a day, if you throw your lot in with this, it's going to be a mess. You know, the other thing too, locusts. There was a plague of locusts. And we talked about this last week, but in Revelation chapter 9, the locusts, once again, just like the frogs represent demon spirits, the locusts also represent demon spirits. It says in chapter 9, verse 1, and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven. We talked about that last week, remember? That's Satan, to me. Satan fell from heaven. He was given a key to the bottomless pit. And that was one of the points that I wanted to make to you. I used to have the hardest time understanding, well, God, why would you allow that to happen? Well, because this is all part of God's plan, according to 2 Thessalonians 2. They refused to believe the truth, so he sent them strong delusion that they might be deceived. And so now it's time for wrath to be poured out. And he said that there were angels that were reserved in chains of darkness in the bottomless pit till the day of judgment. And now this fallen star, which I believe is represents Satan, is given a key to unlock the bottomless pit. And out of it, we don't have to go through the whole thing, come out locusts. And it's not, people used to try to say that it was helicopters. No, it's not helicopters. It's demon spirits, because there's an angel over them, over the abyss. His name is Abaddon. He's the great destroyer. And he's one of those fallen angels that crossed boundaries in the time frame of the book of Genesis, chapter 6. All right. So that was... miracles and deception. You know, the truth is that in this passage of Scripture, it talks about the fact that God's telling Moses, he says, this is Exodus chapter 7, verses 9 and 10. He says, when Pharaoh shall speak unto you, show a miracle for you, then you shall say unto Aaron, take your rod, cast it before Pharaoh, and it shall become a serpent. And Moses and Aaron went in unto Pharaoh, and they did so as the Lord had commanded them. And then if you'll remember the story, Pharaoh turns around and he tells his magicians to throw their rod down, right? And their rod, actually the book of Hebrews tells us, no, 2 Timothy tells us that those two magicians' names, Jannes and Jambres, that they threw their rods down and they also turned into serpents. But then, praise the Lord, Aaron's serpents swallowed up and overcame Pharaoh's serpents. The point though is this, is that don't think that Satan doesn't have power. Don't think he doesn't have deceptive magic. You know, I mean, some of you in this room have experienced some things already. Some of you in this room have even heard people just talk about lies, twisted, deceptive lies that have to do with the Scripture, and that stuff starts standing up on. I've had conversations with some of y'all about that kind of stuff. And I know that there's some of you who even dug in a little bit deeper than that. And I know I've been around some crazy things. And listen, this stuff is nothing to play with. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? That the enemy of our soul, he has some power. And I'm telling you that there are people that are being deceived, even, you know, even as we talk. And so so the beast, talking about miracles and deception. Now that was in Exodus, and I wanted to turn and just read a couple of passages out of the book of Revelation. Talking about miracles and deception, I was still talking about Egypt. I was talking about Pharaoh as a type of Antichrist, but in reality, the way I set this up, it's almost more like Egypt as a type of the world and the things that went on in Egypt and the similarities that are going to take place also in the end days. Which is the world system, and as Pharaoh as the type of Antichrist, and the true Antichrist shows up. But in Revelation chapter 13, starting in verse, let's just go ahead and read that whole passage. We have a little bit of time. Starting in verse 1. I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns. And this is the same beast that we're talking about in Revelation 17. It has 10 horns and 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Now, I would like to just, this is just for people that are interested in this kind of thing. Some people believe that because of this verse right here, that there's that the same fallen angel that helped Alexander the Great is going to help the Antichrist. And the reason that they say that is because of the word leopard that's used right there. Because in Daniel's prophecy of Alexander the Great's kingdom, it was described as a leopard. Okay, some people believe that the Antichrist empire is going to be the revitalized Grecian empire instead of the Roman empire because of that leopard terminology right there. But you know what really stuck out to me more than anything was the fact that the leopard, the bear, and the lion are all mentioned right there. And that the reality of it is that in Daniel's vision that he had, it described those animals, which is, once again, the lion is Babylon, the bear is Medo-Persia, and the leopard, it was Greece. And so what I'm trying to say is that to me, it's really just an amalgamation of all of that. In other words, a mixture and a coming together of all of the Antichrist system, amen, through the years. And that's what it's describing. It's not trying to focus in my opinion, on Greece, but that's just one person's opinion. It goes on to say in verse 3, "And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast." Now I'm going to just take a second right there too. It's my personal opinion that this has a double reference. And what I mean by that is that the revitalized, the Antichrist kingdom, this, we talked about it, the seven-headed beast. Now I'm going to try to shoot from the hip, but Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, number 7, the ten-horned kingdom, number 8, the Antichrist kingdom, which comes from number 7. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that because number 7, the ten-horned kingdom, is the revitalized Roman Empire, I believe that where it says that it was a deadly wound that was healed, because first the beast is this whole system. Does that make sense? I know I've tried to explain that to y'all a bunch of times. I know this is a lot of information, but if we repeat it, I think that we'll understand it better. That this whole beast system, this seven-headed beast of all of these nations that held Israel in bondage, represents the whole beast system. And that this whole beast system has been moving through the ages of humanity, destroying humanity, bringing God's people under subjection to bondage, amen. And that there's been a period of time where we think the Roman Empire has been dead, but the reality of it is that it's been living, I believe, through the Jesuit order and some other secret societies and things like that. But that the first interpretation of it was resurrected. They didn't use the word resurrect, but came back from a mortal head wound, is that head that represents Rome comes back to life. But I also believe that the literal Antichrist will also, there will be a fake or a faux resurrection, if you will, that the literal Antichrist, who is the beast, he literally is called the beast because the beast is the seven-headed beast, right? And then from the seventh kingdom, he receives his kingdom and he's called the beast. And so the seventh empire is resurrected, but also I believe that the Antichrist himself will also die of a mortal head wound, and he will also be resurrected. And the reason why is because everything that he does is a counterfeit and contradistinction to what, or trying to parallel what Jesus did in order to show signs and wonders and to deceive the entirety of the world and to deceive the inhabitants of the world that they would fall into the lie and worship him, all right? And so it goes on to say in verse 4, "They worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. He opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints." Goes on to talk right here in verse 11. Let's skip down real quick. It says, "I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon." He's the false prophet. "And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him. He causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed." And look at this, verse 13. "He does great wonders, so that he makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. He deceives them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which he had to wound by a sword and did live." Now, I was going to try to talk about Nebuchadnezzar tonight, but we're not going to have time to do that. But we are going to end with this. Revelation chapter 11. So remember how in what we talked about in Egypt, there was Aaron and Moses were two witnesses for God, right? And they throw down their rod and it turns into a serpent. And then the Egyptian magicians try to do the same thing. Similar things taking place really in the book of Revelation. You have the beast, which is the Antichrist, and the false prophet. And they're over here with the power of the dragon performing miracles, calling fire down from the sky. But God also has in Revelation chapter 11 his own two witnesses. And it says, it starting in chapter 11 verse 1, there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood saying, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar, and then that, and them that worship therein, and the court which is without the temple leave out and measure it not. For it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they will prophesy 1,260 days, which is 1,260 days. If you divide that by 360, which is a Hebrew year, it comes out to 3.5 years, which is half of the tribulation. These are the two olive trees and two candlesticks. Olive trees is where olive oil comes from, represents anointing. Candlesticks lit up inside the, which was known as the menorah. So anointing and light. They're light. They're light in the midst of the world. They're the witnesses of God in the midst of this tribulation time, standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceeds out of their mouth, devours their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. Now I wanted you to notice real close attention to verse 6. These have power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. So I was just focused on, many people want to know, who are these two witnesses? I don't know about you, but that's an intriguing thought. Who would these two witnesses be? Many people believe that the two witnesses, and we're not even going to turn to these scriptures, but would be Enoch and Elijah. Now, Enoch, according to the New Testament passage, he had this testimony. During the time frame before the flood, when times were wicked, he was a man of God. He was preaching the gospel. He was letting people know, the Lord's coming back with his angels. You need to repent. You need to get your heart right. You need to be right. And the Word of God says that this is what the testimony Enoch had, that God was pleased with him. And one day Enoch was, and then the next day he was translated, and he was no more. And it also says that about Elijah, right? 2 Kings, I think I'm going to preach that on Sunday. And in 2 Kings, well, Elijah, what happens is he's taken up in a whirlwind. Amen? And we're going to talk about the travel or the journey that he went on before he was taken up in the whirlwind, and how it's the pathway of the Christian before he gets taken up to the Lord. And the fact is that Elijah was taken up in the whirlwind. These two men never saw death. The Word of God said his appointment of the man was to die and then the judgment. And these two men have never tasted death. And these two witnesses will also come down upon the earth. They're given power and authority to speak forth the Word of God and to be a witness. And nobody can touch them for a period of time. And then after that period of time, and that beast is loose from the pit. We don't know how long after he's loose. He's able to overcome them and they die. And the whole world is excited. You remember when 9/11 happened and you turn on the TV and all of those people over there in those Middle Eastern countries were burning American flags and they were all happy? That's what it's going to be like whenever these witnesses die. Because they were sitting there and they were preaching the eternal gospel to the whole world who hated God. And they couldn't stop them and they couldn't get their mouths shut. And once they die and their bodies are laid in the street, the people are going to be so excited. They're going to be throwing a party. But then after, I think it's 3.5 days, their bodies are resurrected from the dead. And the Lord says, come up hither! And he brings them up. Amen? Praise God. That sounds like that ought to be right. I just got this interesting concept, though. And it always bothered me. It's like I never did understand what the story was with Moses. Why this thing in Jude? And this is just something for you to think about. All right? In Revelation chapter 11, verse 6, what we just read, what did it say? These have power to shut heaven that it rain not. You remember what Elijah did? Elijah had the power to stop the rain. Remember that? And he also had to, whenever it was time to speak it, then the rain came. Right? So we talked about Elijah, and he was taken up in the whirlwind. But they also have power over the waters to turn them to blood. And so here we have Moses, who was with Aaron, and whenever they're turning the waters into blood, look what it also says, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they do.
But Moses died. I understand that. But look at Jude chapter 1, verse 9. I never did really understand why. It says, yet Michael the archangel...
Well, first, before we even go there, I'm sorry. Let me go over here.
Deuteronomy 34, 5 and 6. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab according to the word of the Lord, and he buried him in a valley in the land of Moab over against Beth Peor, but no man knows of his sepulcher unto this day. Now either God himself buried Moses, or he had some angels bury Moses, but the word of God says that no man knows of his sepulcher or his tomb unto this day. God purposefully had Moses buried in the spot where nobody knew where he was. And in this passage here, Jude chapter 1 verse 9, we're told, yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuked thee. So Michael the archangel and Satan himself are fighting over the body of Moses. I'm not saying that the reason that they're fighting is because God wanted to take it to heaven because he's going to be one of the two witnesses at the end. I just always thought that this was interesting and it's just something to think about. And if you ever get to that passage of scripture. Now, one of the main things that we should probably really learn from this scripture more than anything is that we shouldn't be so high and mighty in ourselves thinking that we're going to, with our confession or our own tongue, just rebuke the devil and he's going to run and flee. If the archangel Michael dare not bring a railing accusation against him, but say the Lord rebuke thee, Satan. We also need to be reminded of who the power source is behind our words. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord.